The race is not to the swift, brothers. This, what we're in is not to the swift. I know, brothers, we want to study, study, study. He that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. Remember that. He didn't say rush, 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 rush. A lot of times, brothers rush. Brothers and sisters rush. I'm going to tell you what happens. They burn out. Brothers and sisters that rush, oh, I know this and I know that. Those are the ones I always see that burn out in this truth. They burn out. They lose that steam that they once had. In this walk, in this truth, we have to prepare our minds for what the Lord has prepared for us. We got to prepare our minds, men and women, okay? The things that help us prepare our minds is the words of the Most High. We got to understand what our race is, what the race is in this truth. Listen good, listen good, listen good. Well, I'm going to tell you what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about brothers. We're going to talk about sisters too. We want to make sure everybody understands their role in Israel. I want you brothers to understand your role, and I definitely want the sisters to understand their role. I don't want no confusion. God is not unrighteous. Forget your work and labor of love. Labor of love, like we read earlier, do all things with brotherly, do all things with charity. That's that brother's love. You love this truth. You love the brotherhood. You love this nation. You love your people.
We've been doing this work for quite a long time. Myself, over 25 years. Deacon Yalasop, 24, I believe. Bishop Kanai, 23. So we've been doing this for quite a long time. And one thing we've learned is that, can we read that, Captain Isaac?
Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 11.
Listen good, listen good, listen good. Well, I'm going to tell you what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about brothers. We're going to talk about sisters, too. We want to make sure everybody understands their roles in Israel. I want you brothers to understand your role, and I definitely want the sisters to understand their role. I don't want no confusion. New levels, new devils. It's an old expression. Ecclesiastes 9:11, please.
I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift.
The race is not to the swift, brothers. The race. This, what we're in, is not to the swift. I know, brothers, we want to study, study, study. But Christ said, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. Remember that. He didn't say rush, 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 rush. A lot of times brothers and sisters rush. I'm going to tell you what happens. They burn out. Brothers and sisters that rush, oh, I know this and I know that. Those are the ones I always see that burn out in this truth. They burn out. They lose that steam that they once had. For example, real quick, give me Mark 4. Mark 4. We're going to come back to Ecclesiastes. When brothers and sisters come in this truth and it's rush, 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 I got to know everything now. I want to know it now, or they get an attitude if you don't give it to them now. This is really where they fall into. Let me see. Give me Mark 4 and verse 3. I mean, verse 18, I'm sorry.
Mark 4, verse 18. And these are they which are sown among thorns.
This is the third type of Israelite Christ gives an example of. There's four types. There's only four types of Israelites in this walk. The third one is the one that I want to discuss in brief. Go ahead.
Such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in.
See that? The lust of other things. That covers a whole spectrum right there. That covers, let me tell you also what it covers that many times we don't think about. It covers power. I'm going to explain what I mean by that, what I mean by power. Power and authority. Men, black and Latin men, we've never had nothing in this world. And meaning America's world is what I'm talking about. We've never had nothing. And there's an expression about it's a dangerous thing to put power and authority into the hands of a man who's never had nothing. Right, the hands of a fool. Because what does he do? He abuses the authority, the power that he has. He begins to smite the brothers, smite the sisters, because he's never had nothing. So he abuses the authority he's given. So when it says the lust of other things, I'm going back to that now. When brothers come in and say, like many, How long was it before I went over with y'all about the 12 feathers in 2 Ezra chapter 11?
Man, listen. Me and Item been pressing the elder for the longest. We got it the same time you all got it. We never got it.
I went slow with them to make sure that nobody was power hungry. I always notice when you see that spirit that got to know everything today, that's a power hungry brother right there. And he wants to get the info for a selfish gain. Preeminence. Thank you. I like that word. Preeminence. Read that again for me, officer.
And the lust of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful.
Many of the brothers we see that have fell out this truth, who said they learned 3 chapters, I'm going to go out and do my thing. Dun, 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 dun. Brothers like that, and then we get the call, we want to come back. Why you want to come back? Because I need to learn. You didn't know you need to learn when you was with us for that time? Why? Because the spirit of preeminence was on them. I know exactly what y'all know. No, you don't. We don't bring everything out. We take every man in stages. And it has to be like that. Okay? Go back to Ecclesiastes 9 and 11.
Ecclesiastes 9, verse 11. I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill. But time and chance happeneth to them all.
Time and chance happeneth to them all. So, time and chance has happened upon this body of believers right here. Time and chance. Get me 1 Ezra 9. So, in this walk, in this truth, we have to prepare our minds for what the Lord has prepared for us. We got to prepare our minds, men and women, okay? The things that help us prepare our minds is the words of the Most High. We got to understand what our race is, what the race is in this truth, what our roles are. Give me 1 Ezra 9:41. Verse 41 is what I want.
First Esdras, chapter 9, verse 41. And he read in the broad court before the holy porch from morning unto midday, before both men and women, and all the multitude gave heed unto the law.
Very important you men understand that. I know a lot of y'all like to window shop. Y'all listen to other Israelite camps, and there's no problem with that. You listen to who you want to listen to. Y'all grown folks. But just don't track no doo-doo up in here. Because we will smell it. The scriptures say men and women. And the reason I'm stressing it, because you have several camps out there that say women have no part or lot in this truth. And we're going to smell you if you come in with that doctrine. Okay? So we're going to show what the scriptures say, men and women. You cannot have a nation without women. I don't know what's going on. Ain't going to be no sausage fest up in here. Sword fighting. That ain't happening. Give me Ecclesiasticus chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13 about our duty.
Ecclesiastes 12, verse 13. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter.
If you never understood what your role is, what your purpose in life is, King Solomon tells you right here.
Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man.
Fear God and keep his commandments. For that is the whole duty of man. Many times we live our lives in confusion because we have no purpose. Our lives are not the same lives as the other nations. Meaning, the other nations have a purpose, meaning they are brought up from youth. They are given a role to play in society. Whether it's entrepreneurial, whether it is distributor, producer, things of that nature. Their children are instructed what they're going to be from youth. Our people are the only ones not given that. The white man has allowed us, I'm using that for a reason, to run wild in society. Do whatever you want. Yeah, I can do whatever I want. Yeah, do whatever you want. Well, how come those Chinese kids over there, they don't do what they want? How come they do this? A, B, the white man never says they have a goal, they have a purpose. What about those East Indian? They have a goal, they have a purpose. What about them Arab kids over there? They have a goal, they have a purpose. But y'all, Just run wild. Whatever you want, just do you. You're an individual. You know, we're the only group that think our people are the only ones that think that dumbness. Is that a word, dumbness?
Yeah, that'll work.
If it ain't, I made it now. Right. Copyright that word.
You know what's amazing about that do what you want to do stuff? That do what you want to do stuff is an illusion. Yep. Because the stuff that you really do is within the parameters of what he allow you to do. Right. You stupid as hell to think that you have your own mind. And you're doing exactly what he got. He's got the parameters of what exactly what you're going to do. And you've been trained that way through education, through religion, through just the justice systems. All of the systems have perfectly guided you within the parameters of which you will carry your life out with your so-called free mind.
Exactly. The get Luke 17. Now, we just read Ecclesiastes 7, 12 and 13 about here's the whole duty of man, fear God and keep his commandments. Let me tell you about that. The individual who's been brought up, who is the Americanized individual, many of them on Facebook. And if you look at many of the comments on some of these posts, you always read, I never read the comments on many of the other videos, but you be reading comments. And you see the same people on Facebook pretty much you see on YouTube. And these are the ones, men and women, that say, I'll do me, I'm an individual. I'm going to keep the commandments by myself. I don't deal with camps. I don't deal with structure. But that's not biblical. And by keeping the commandments, there's many things that you're not doing. Like one commandment is, thank you. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. I'm thinking about Leviticus 23 about the holy convocation. So as an individual, you can't do that. You by yourself. Now it's different if some people may be online. They live in states where they're only Israelite. That's different. We ain't talking about that. We talking about right there in your city. There's an Israelite camp. I'm not going to fellowship with them. So you're not keeping the commandments. Read that again, Officer Leon.
Luke 17.
Yes, Luke 17. I want this to precept with Ecclesiastes 12, 13. So when it says the whole duty of man is to fear God and keep the commandments, Christ said the same thing, but look what he says. Watch this.
What verse?
Verse 20 and 21.
Luke 17, verse 20. And when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God cometh not with observation.
Stop. That's a message to the individual Israelite. The kingdom of God does not come with observation. Why? Because the individual Israelite said, I keep the commandments. I'm good. But our job is to bring forth the kingdom of heaven. Read.
Neither shall they say, lo here or lo there. For behold, the kingdom of God is within you.
The kingdom of God is within you. That precepts with fear God and keep his commandments. You got to do something with those commandments. You studying, you learning. What you going to do with it? Sure, you might, now the beginning, don't get me wrong, the beginning of all that is fixing who? Is it the commandments meant to fix my neighbor first or fix me first? Right, fix me. Once I fix me, now I go to my brother. Now I go to my sister. There's steps in this thing. Fear God and keep his commandments. The kingdom of God is within you. It does not come with observation. Oh, look, here comes the kingdom. It ain't happening. Christ is letting you know you got to work. That's what he's saying. You got to give me that in Matthew 5, Officer Liam. You know what I want, Matthew 5? I don't know it off the top of my head. The one about you are the light of the world, that one.
Matthew 5, verse 14. Ye are the light of the world.
So the ye there is you Israelites who fear God, keep his commandments. You Israelites who understand that the kingdom of God is within you and it does not come with observation. He said what?
Ye are the light of the world.
Christ said, you are the light of the world. Go ahead.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid.
He said, you Israelites are like a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. Go ahead.
Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house.
So the commandments that you're learning, that you're studying, that you are applying to your lives is meant to be as light for all Israel. So that individual Israelite does not know what he or she thinks they know. They're deceiving themselves. Understand that they're deceiving themselves. So with all that understanding, here we go, Deuteronomy 7:6. We fail to understand is that we are a special people. The Most High didn't make us like the other nations. He did not make us like the other nations. Go ahead.
Deuteronomy 7, verse 6. For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God.
So once you fear God and keep his commandments, once you understand that the kingdom of heaven is within you, once you understand that you are the light of the world and that light is meant to give light to all that is in the house, you understand that you are a special people. Go ahead.
The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
So there's something about us that the Most High understands that we don't understand because of our low self-esteem. He said within Israelites, the Israelite man, the Israelite woman, there's a spirit in them, and they are special, and they are above every nation on the planet Earth. We have to start to believe that. Give me Deuteronomy 28. So, fear God, keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. The kingdom of heaven is within you. You are the light of the world. Watch this. Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 6. So you keep the commandments, right? Go ahead.
Deuteronomy 28, verse 1. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
That stipulation is not for the other nations. The other nations are set up on high above us in wickedness. We try to emulate them, and we always get the short end of the stick. And want to know why, Lord. How come we as a people are not successful like the other nations? Because remember, Deuteronomy 28 is talking about the nation. You always got that one Negro who's the individual. That's, well, I'm like Oprah. I'm above it. You simple as hell. Oprah only got that position because the white man allowed her to have that position. No matter what famous black man, actor, athlete you can think of, they are there because the white man allowed them to be there. Because they are the puppets of white society. Read that again.
Which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
Uh-huh.
And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee, if thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God.
So if we hearken unto the voice of the Lord our God, these blessings shall come upon us. What verse was that?
That was verse 2.
Go ahead.
Verse 3. Blessed shalt thou be in the city.
So if we keep the commandments, God said, whatever city you in, you're going to be blessed. Go ahead.
And blessed shalt thou be in the field.
And whatever fields we're in, we shall be blessed. Go ahead.
Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body.
He said, and your children shall be blessed if you keep my commandments. Go ahead.
And the fruit of thy ground.
Uh-huh.
And the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep.
Go ahead.
Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store.
Meaning your businesses. Whatever business you put your hands to, God says, listen, if you mobilize like the way I'm telling Israel to mobilize, you special people. Notice he didn't say, he said Israel is a special people, not a special person. Did he say person or people? Meaning we got to work together. He said that's when the blessings come. That's when you're special as a people, not a person. Go ahead.
Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest
out. So we're going to be blessed when we're born into the earth and blessed when we pass from this earth. That's what the Most High said. That's what keeping his laws does with us as a unit, as a body. Okay, and we have not learned that in society. Give me Matthew 18. There's a power and blessings in obeying God's law. This is why Christ said this in Matthew 18, verse 19 and 20. Matthew 18, verse 19 and 20.
Matthew chapter 18, verse 19.
Uh-huh.
Again, I say unto you.
Listen good.
That if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven.
I want y'all to see how it starts there. It's never the individual. He said, let's start with two. That's why in another scripture in Ecclesiastes, it says two is better than one. And three is a cord not easily broken. That's the beginning. Okay? He said, if two of you agree on anything in my name, I'm there. Christ, when it says in his name, it's talking about in this, not Yahabasham, Yahushabrak. It ain't talking about that. It's talking about you agreeing his name on what this book says.
That's the Psalms 133.
Right, this is Psalms 133. How beautiful it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. That's when things get done. That's when blessings come down. Go ahead.
Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven.
Go ahead.
For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them.
There am I in the midst of them. There am I in the midst of them.
The Most High said that whenever we are gathered together in his name, that's what Psalms 133 was talking about. I was listening to when we was talking about those people that go on Facebook and things like that, and they think they're being individuals. Because like I was making a point before, there's no such thing. You're not really individuals. You are still clumped in a group. Because if you examine the majority of the comments, and you was asking me about me reading the comments. When I read the comments are all generalized in just a few areas. Regardless of what kind of different people they're speaking, they're all general. All of their comments generally fall into one or two categories. Can I get a witness? Okay, they either hate the law, they want to be a whoremonger. It's always something. It's always a group. So they all are grouped together regardless. The problem is that they're not disciplined enough to be in the group of the Most High. They're not disciplined enough to be in the righteousness and the order that the Most High is talking about, like we was talking about in Psalms 133. That particular group is the group that the Most High wants us to be involved in, but society makes us believe that you're in some kind of organization or something as opposed to what the Most High wants. So you put in your mind, say, you know what, I'm going to be an individual. You're not being an individual at all. You're still clumped together with people that are still about doing wickedness. And that is a lot of words. I hope y'all understood the point of that. You're not an individual. You're either going to be grouped together under the Most High or you're going to be grouped together in wickedness. But you ain't never an individual.
Give me Revelation 19:13. Because somebody right now, the reason I want to go here, somebody right now might be saying, well, it says gather together in his name. Doesn't that mean Yahabasham, Yahushai, Barakatha? Doesn't that mean Yahweh, Yuhay, Wav, Hey? I saw a video where people was arguing. Israelites were arguing, almost got into a fist fight over the name. And I'm sitting there watching the video. I said, this is some crazy Negro stuff. They were having a nigger moment. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
You know I know about the nigger moment.
I was waiting for the chair to be thrown. I said, here go the chair. There you go.
Oh, my God, a chair.
I'm mad, man.
Arguing about Yuhay Wav Hey, Yahweh, Yahshua, I mean arguing. Then one brother stood up to fight the other brother. I don't know if y'all know what I'm talking about. I said, this is crazy. Give me that, Revelation 19:13.
Revelation 19, verse 13. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God.
His name is called the Word of God. So when Christ said, if two of you are gathered together in my name, he's talking about this. He's not talking about a Hebrew pronunciation. Okay? That's why I go to Matthew 24, which I read 2 weeks ago, about many shall come in my name and deceive many. Go back to that one. You know what I'm talking about?
Matthew 24, verse 4. And Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many.
So you see, my brother, that means Hebrew. So who went throughout the Americas saying, Yahabasham, Yahushai, Barakatha, and deceived everybody? Where is that historically written? It never happened. They came in the English and Spanish pronunciation of Christos or Christ and deceived everybody. In other words, they came with this and deceived everybody. It's not a Hebrew pronunciation. Y'all got to get off that simplicity or you will be seen on video about to fist fight the next brother. Nah, brother, because this letter here is the Ayin. And this letter is the Yad. And this one is Chayv. See, you don't know about that. You ain't deep.
brother. I'm looking at this, this is some foolishness here. Anyway. There's, give me Zephaniah 2 and 1. Give me Zephaniah 2. I'm going to get hate mail tonight. It's all right. I always do. Give me Zephaniah 2 and 1. Y'all know this. Y'all know this.
Zephaniah 2 verse 1. Gather yourselves together, yea. Gather together, O nation not desired.
So the Most has always been about solidarity. Always been about unity. Always. One mind, one goal, one aim. One faith, one Lord. Y'all know I can't quote. I'm just throwing things out there. But the Most High has always been about that, Ephesians 4. Right. Now, from there, get me Isaiah. Give me Isaiah 20. I want to talk about the sisters. I just love talking about women. I just love y'all. I love y'all so much. I got to talk about you. I got an email this week and said, how come every class you brothers give, I guess not just New York, she said statewide, every class, the sister says to me, every class that y'all give, women are wicked Jezebels and must shut their big black lips. That's what she wrote me. I said, sister, I don't even know you. I said, how come we can get on the brothers and say some of you brothers are effeminate? Some of you brothers raised by your mamas. Some of you brothers don't have a clue. And it's not a problem. No emails from the brother. No emails. But from the women. It's always that woman that get hit in the head with the shoe. Boop! Oh, that's me. That's me. I got to curse him now.
I want to know if a brother understand what you just threw out there.
Go ahead. Ask him.
What was the point that the bishop is making? Because y'all know we get on brothers. Y'all know that. Can I get a witness? About being undisciplined, out of order, brothers being out of order, not taking care of their families, all kind of things. We tear brothers up, especially if they come sideways. We're going to tear them up. Y'all seen us stand brothers up that came with foolishness and got thrown out of here. Y'all seen all of that. Have nobody called in and said, why do we jump on the brothers?
Right.
But because we throw the shoe on the sister side that need the whole room full of shoes thrown at them sometimes. We throw one shoe, not even a pair, just one shoe.
Yeah.
Just the strap of the shoe, just left it, you know, and then we get an email.
Exactly.
I'm going to ask you, brothers, why is that? Need to throw some combat boots over there. But go ahead. Who can answer? You. I see the brother with his hand up. To the bishop's point, I just try to reframe it. Shalom, brother. We hear you.
We're not afraid of correction.
We're not afraid of correction. Okay. All right. I'm asking, let me set the question up again. Why is it that the sister felt, I'm giving it away. She felt confident enough to
She's
call
guilty.
Us with that mess.
She's guilty.
Okay. I think I gave it away now. That ain't the answer. I think Jonah got his hand up. I need to hear the psychosis behind that answer, behind that statement. I didn't go too deep on you, did I? Go ahead.
Because they're emotional. Emotions. You said felt, right?
Yeah, but that's okay. General. Get into it.
It's the. All right, I'm lost now.
All right, one more, and I'm gonna give it up. Josiah, you got something for me? Do I need to reframe it again? Brothers get blasted every week. Y'all all right? Nobody calls and say anything. Sister hears something that sounds almost remotely close to them. She feels confident enough to get on the phone and call the bishop. Bishop have to respond, woman, I don't even know you. The hell is this? But why does she feel like she had to say something? And what's behind it? Come on.
Because in this society, she's been set up over the men.
Thank you. That's the answer. Did y'all get that? She felt like, listen, y'all could talk about each other, but y'all can't talk about me. You got brothers that are afraid to address these women. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why she said, well, I'm going to call and get him straight.
Thank you. There you go, right there. And then she says, why y'all always talk about, remember, who's with me? Isaac. Remember the sister in Jamaica? Me not gwan shut up for no man. Remember that? Gave us a whole spiel.
That's the spirit. That's the attitude.
But today, we're not going to go over the shuff up scriptures. That's the Hebrew word we made up, shuff up. It's an acronym. Look it up. We ain't going to touch on that today. We're not going into the shut the hell up scripture. We ain't going into that. We're going to examine the roles of the men and the roles of the women. Give me Isaiah 28 and 9. I'm going to start with the sisters. Isaiah 28 and 9.
Isaiah 28, verse 9. Whom shall he teach knowledge?
Whom shall the Lord teach knowledge? Go ahead. Come on, come on. Give me your mic.
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
Uh-huh.
Them that are weaned from the milk.
So the ones that's going to understand doctrine and knowledge are them that are weaned. Go ahead.
From the milk.
Uh-huh.
And drawn from the breast.
To be weaned is an example of what? Who knows what that makes reference to when you're weaned? You're what? You're being what? Yes.
Weaned means you're being taught, or in worldly sense, breastfed.
Right. In a worldly sense, the natural sense, talk about being breastfed. That's what it's talking about. And when you read the scriptures, children were breastfed generally for 3 years. Okay. It says, them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. God is comparing his word to breasts. The understanding, the doctrine, and the knowledge to the milk that comes out of the breast. I know y'all looking at me, right? Yeah. Give me 1 Peter. We're going to jump from there. Watch. I'm getting somewhere. 1 Peter 2, 1 to 3. So there's two covenants. You have an old covenant. You got the new covenant. How many breasts a woman got? She got two.
Hopefully.
Well, she got two, right? Milk comes out of the Old Testament. Milk comes out of the New Testament. Knowledge, doctrine, comes out of the woman's breast. Watch this. It's an analogy that God gave Isaiah to give us. Watch this. 1 Peter 2, 1 to 3.
1. Wherefore, laying aside all malice.
And coming out of this world, brothers, we've been brought up, black men, Latin men, we've been brought up in malice. Can we look up that word? Because that's not an everyday word we use. Can we look up the word malice? I don't know what it means. I always forget. Okay. Desire to inflict injury, harm, suffering on another, either because of a hostile impulse or out of deep-seated meanness. Evil intent. Okay. So malice. Coming out of the world, we are brought up understanding and learning malice. Some brothers were in gangs. Some brothers did their own thing and did things that were not nice. Read on.
And all guile.
And can we look up that word guile? Let's look up that word. That's not an everyday word either. Guile. G-U-I-L-E. What that mean? Sly, cunning, intelligence. Give me some more meanings. And there's some other words I want. See that? I see the word more. Go up, 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 right there. Okay, deceit. I like that. I can understand that. Trickery. Tricks, schemes, ploys, wiles, slyness. See, I like those words. Deception. Yep. Here's the proof. Y'all know y'all very deceitful. Women to tell you. How many times you tell a woman you're going to marry her? Just to get her. Then when you get her, get to stepping. I ain't marrying your behind. Deceitful. How many times brothers say, I love you. Girl, you know I love you. Psych. After you say psych, after you smash it. Psych. Now you don't want to know more. Back to 1 Peter 2. Watch this.
Wherefore laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies.
And hypocrisy. Go ahead.
And envies.
And envies. Go ahead.
And all evil speakings.
And all evil. Now, these spirits that we're reading about, those attributes is what all of us have in us from youth up. Go ahead.
As newborn babes.
Now, give me a new term for newborn. Give me another word for newborn. Repent. I like that word. What else? Change. I like change, too. That's good. Give me another one. Transform. I like that. That's a scripture. I like that. Go ahead. Bethink. Okay, I can roll with that. I like that. 1 Kings 8. Go ahead. Oh, I like that one. Born again. That's right. All of those are synonyms. They all mean the same thing. Read that again, Officer Liam.
As newborn babes,
meaning as changed men and women,
desire,
born again men and women, transformed men and women. Go ahead.
Desire the sincere milk of the word.
We got to desire the sincere milk of the word. Go ahead. The sincere milk of the word, in case you don't know, is not the deep mysteries of the Bible. The sincere milk of the word. What did Moses command us to teach our children in Deuteronomy? Might be chapter 6 or chapter 4. I can't remember off the top. Chapter 4. What did he command us? Get that, Officer Liam, because some of us don't know. Deuteronomy, is it 4? 6 and 4? Where it says, when you go by with sleep, walk by the way. Deuteronomy 6. Read verse 1 about what it's talking about, then jump down.
Deuteronomy 6, verse 1. Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land whither you go to possess it.
Now jump down to the children.
Verse 7. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes.
So when children are born and they're breastfeeding, remember what we read in Isaiah, them that are weaned from the milk, drawn from the breast. When children are born, we are commanded to give them God's laws. Not 2 Esdras 12. What is the 12 feathers? And who are the 12 harpers? Who was the elders in Revelation that stood up before Christ? What are their names? I don't know. We don't know. We're going to wait and find out. But that's, wait on that. Let's deal with the milk of the scriptures. Read that. Back to 1 Peter. This is what most Israelites don't want. 1 Peter 2 and 2.
As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word.
Why?
That ye may grow thereby.
That you may grow. If you ever look at other, many, I ain't going to say all, some Israelite camps who've been around some 30 years, they've not grown. Because they're not dealing in the milk of God. They're not dealing with the basics. They went, oh, see, you don't know who the 13 families of the Illuminati are. You're right, I don't know. And I don't give a damn. It has nothing to do with our salvation. So what, you know, the Rockefellers, the DuPonts, all these people. What is that going to profit you? Nothing. Y'all understand that? It's not going to profit you nothing. So you know all the secret counsels of the white man. Do you have power to change, alter, or transform them things? No. The King Alfred plan, brother. Jade Helm, brother. What was when y'all supposed to be in camps this month? Say it on the mic. Nobody can hear you. Somebody help Python. Yeah.
Are they working? What? September 15th? July 15th to September 15th was Jade Helm concentration camp months. We're all still here, right? Anyone been to camp lately? And yeah, I haven't been to camp.
But some of you sit back and watch that stuff. Some of y'all be like, ooh, I'm going to write that down, write that down. Now you hear crickets, right? Now everybody want to make believe they never said that crap. All those, the Lord showed me a mystery. Meanwhile, their Lord is Alex Jones. Is that Edomite's name? Mm. That's their Lord. He said such and such. Yeah, okay. What's that, Asa? Hello?
And then when it don't happen, they say that Illuminati heard them speak about it, so they changed their plan.
But I do believe some of y'all fall for that. I do believe some of y'all fall for that.
Any stupid conspiracy that they come up with, if they'll tell all their men to speak about it for months, and when it don't happen, they'll say they was watching us. These high-level people was watching these bums on the street, and they said, let's change their plan because of those bums.
Exactly. Y'all got to be crazy. So, back to 2 Peter 2 and 2.
As 1 Peter 2, verse 2. As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby.
Uh-huh.
If so be, ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious.
You will only desire the sincere milk of the word if you what, Leon?
If so be, ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious.
If you've have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Some of us have been in some situation that we know that the Lord is gracious. Some of us were preparing our lives for other things. And when we heard the call, we know that the Lord is gracious. We said, the Lord is calling me. I got whatever my plans was, is on halt, is stopped. Now I'm going back this way because the Lord want me that way. So we have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Was that it?
That's it.
Okay, we're going to say y'all stop? Okay, so now get me 2 Ezra 14:34. So God compares the milk of the scriptures to a woman's breast. That's the comparison. That's Isaiah 20. That's his analogy, his similitude. Okay, 2 Ezra 14:34. So when you get this milk in you, you learn this knowledge, this doctrine. It's meant to put off malice, guile. What else do we read? Malice, guile, hypocrisy, envies. Oh, that's what the laws do. The mysteries don't do that. The laws do that. You can squeeze it in now?
I can squeeze it in now. The bishop was making a point that when you got camps out there that is teaching about the Illuminati, the King Alfred Pran, whatever the guy's name is, all this other wild, crazy stuff, and the bishop said it's not going to profit them anything. So the question is, if it's not going to profit them anything, why do they do it? Because there is something that they do get. Can I just get one scripture, Bishop? Go to the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verse 5. There is something that they get, but it ain't what we're talking about, because it's supposed to profit you in growth in the spirit. Go ahead.
Matthew 6, verse 5.
Listen good now.
And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward.
What is their reward that they got? Huh? Somebody said it. What is the fame that they got? Do y'all understand what this verse? Read it again.
For they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward.
So what is the reward that they get for doing that?
They want
to. I hear you. Just speak.
They want to be seen of men.
That's their reward. That's all they're going to get. Okay? That's what they're going to get. So that's why they do the Illuminati business. I'm going back to them things. Illuminati, King Alfred, all that other stuff that y'all talking about. Because there are people that call them up. Man, that was deep. Man, that was something. That was this. But is it changing their lives? No. Is it doing anything to better their families? No. So the only thing they get is being told, oh, you're the deep elders and you're the this, that, the other. Huh? That's an audience. But it's not profiting them anything. Going back to your point, it doesn't profit them nothing.
Exactly. Get us 2 Ezra 14. So this milk, which is the doctrine and knowledge of the Most High, which is his laws, is meant to change us. You can't get nothing accomplished in this world unless you're changed by the word of the Most High. Give me that, 2 Ezra 14:34.
2 Ezra 14:34. Therefore, if so be that you will subdue your own understanding.
Your own understanding is malice, guile, hypocrisy, envyings. That's what we were reading. That's our natural understanding. That's why, notice businesses that blacks and Hispanics set up. Look at those record companies that they set up. When you examine them, what happens a lot? There's internal fighting. Somebody murders somebody. Somebody takes all the money and skips town. Y'all don't read that in the news? That's what you read. That's what happens when you get black businesses that try to come together.
So none of them fell because they didn't know the history of the Illuminati?
No.
None of them fell because of the King Alfred plan and the rest of the stuff?
Right. No, no.
It all fell because of the simple Negro, the rudiments of sin, those base elements of sin, envy, hate, malice.
Exactly.
Greed.
Yep.
Those are the things that destroy.
That's why
that's what this Bible is supposed to be fixing up.
Exactly. One more time.
Therefore, if so be that you will subdue your own understanding and reform your hearts.
Word reform there means change. Word reform there means transform. Word reform there means convert. What was it again? Reform there means to, give me another word. Be born again. All those mean the same thing. Go ahead.
ye shall be kept alive, and after death, ye shall obtain mercy.
Exactly. So that's what being born again means. Subdue your own understanding. That's why it's hard for a smart person to... You ever, your mama say, you're so smart that you're stupid. Those college brothers, and I went to college, but I ain't in that category. You get some brothers, some sisters that are so educated, they cannot grasp the Bible. That's that smart, stupid brother or sister. The deep dummies. They can't get it. They can't get it. So now, reform is the change, which is the convert, which is the reconditioning of the Negro or Latino mind. That's what it means. Watch this. So now, the Most High compared his word to what in Isaiah 28? What did he compare it to? Milk coming out of where? Okay, get me Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon. There you go. 8:8. Bear with me. Let me get it because I got to read along with you on this one. Song of Solomon 8:8-10. Go ahead.
Song of Solomon 8:8.
Now, Song of Solomon, many people say, oh, it's a beautiful love story. It's so beautiful. Many people don't. I'm going to tell you something. Song of Solomon is a very hard book. It's not easy. It's reminiscent of Genesis, the third chapter. It's hard like that. It's hard like some of the books in Daniel. Hard like some of the books of Revelation. Hard like that. But watch this.
Song of Solomon 8:8. We have a little sister, and she hath no breast.
This is for all the flat-chested sisters out there. But what this is really talking about is the northern kingdom. You had the kingdom of Judah that was following behind the Most High, and the northern kingdom who had gone off following idolatry. Read it again.
We have a little sister, and she hath no breast. What shall we do for our sister in the day when she shall be spoken for?
What shall we do for the northern kingdom in the day that the Lord calls her? Calls them in. Go ahead.
If she be a wall, we will build upon her a palace of silver.
We will build upon her a palace of silver. Meaning, metaphorically, teach them the scriptures so they can be grow up strong. Go ahead.
And if she be a door, we will enclose her with boards of cedar.
Uh-huh.
I am a wall. In my breast like towers, then was I in his eyes as one that found faith.
So the analogy is, Solomon says in the spirit about the church, about Judah, it said, my breasts are like towers, them big ones, double D's. I laugh when I read through this stuff sometimes, I just got to chuckle. Watch this. Let's see the explanation for it. Give me Titus chapter 2 for you women. Listen good. Titus chapter 2, verse 3 and 4. What shall we do for her in the day that she is spoken for? Now I'm swinging this back to women. No, I'm not talking about their breast size. They are who they are, and you brothers like what y'all like. Some brothers like big ones. Some brothers like little ones. Some brothers like middle ones. Let me change the subject. Anyway. Titus. Right. Titus chapter 2.
Titus chapter 2,
verse 3 and 4.
The aged women likewise. That they be in behavior as becometh holiness.
Uh-huh.
Not false accusers,
meaning gossipers.
Not given to much wine.
Not drunkards.
Teachers of good things.
So the older women are supposed to be teachers of good things. And he's going to explain exactly what he's talking about. Is he talking about leading a class? Let's see. Go ahead.
That they may teach the young women to be sober.
They're to teach these young girls how to be sober, be clear in their understanding about this Bible, what this Bible is talking about. Be clear in their understanding that they're not to be high on weed, high on drugs, high on alcohol. They're supposed to be sober minded. So these older sisters are supposed to guide these younger sisters in that. Go ahead.
To love their husbands.
They got to teach them to love their husbands because that don't come natural. All you child support brothers, y'all know what I'm talking about. Because that woman you had is the devil, the Bible speaks of.
And she's putting you through it right now. Why? Because she was not taught how to love you. Read that again.
To love their husbands, to love their children.
Right. Go ahead.
To be discreet.
To be discreet.
Chase.
Chase.
Keepers at home.
Keepers at not run, not gallivanting on the street. That has to be taught. Was that verse 4?
Good. Obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed.
That the word of God be not blasphemed. Let me show you the next level for a woman. Yes, Baba, go ahead.
Yeah, read the end of the verse again.
That to be discreet, chaste keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed.
Because their older sister is supposed to teach her how to obey her husband. That's how she's going to love her husband, obey her husband. Because she's supposed to learn from who? From her husband. That's what the job of the older sister is supposed to tell her. Listen to your husband, sister. You understand me? But our sisters is not doing that. Even though the elder tell them, they do their own thing.
Go ahead. Let me tell you something about loving the husband. The word of God is so powerful. The word of God is what keeps marriages together. Notice, if we were not in the scriptures, many arguments that men have had with their wives would have ended in divorce if the word of God was not involved. That's why it's important that you bind yourself to these laws and you have a wife that loves the Lord and is going to bind herself to this. Say, we're going to do what that book says. The second y'all walk up out of here and go back in the world and she's with her girlfriends and you with your boys, let y'all get in an argument. Watch what her girlfriends tell her and watch what your boys tell you. Leave. I wouldn't put up with that. Out. To hell with them. And I've seen it from many of the schools in the past. I've seen it. Brothers walk out. I see the wife. Hey, sis, how you doing? I'm doing all right. How's your husband? We ain't together no more. Like, yep, there we go. And it's the same thing from person to person. Where did you end that?
That's it.
Give me 2 Maccabees 7. Let me show you about these women. I'm talking about the role of the woman just for the moment. I'm going to get to the brothers in a moment, but right now I'm talking about the sisters. So, we just read. Yeah.
We don't have to qualify that we're going to go back to the brothers. We stay on the sisters all day if we need to. You know why I said that, right? Because we ain't going to always say we're getting on the brothers. We're going to stay where we need to stay with the Bible.
You're absolutely right. What was I going to say? Oh, Titus. The women are to show these young women, teach them good things. Teach them to teach these young women how to love their husband, love their children, because that don't come naturally. Now, here's another one. 2 Maccabees 7:27.
2 Maccabees 7:27. But she, bowing herself toward him, laughing the cruel tyrant to scorn.
This is the sister that bowed herself. And she raised up 7 sons. She raised up 7 sons. And this is what she did with one of her sons. She bowed herself to him. Go ahead.
Spake in her country language.
That was Hebrew. Go ahead.
On this manner.
Watch.
O my son, have pity upon me that bear thee 9 months in my womb.
She said, have pity upon me. I bared you in my womb for 9 months. Go ahead.
And gave thee suck 3 years.
That's what I was saying earlier about children were weaned for 3 years. Go ahead.
And nourished thee, and brought thee up unto this age.
And I brought thee up unto this age, meaning the age he currently was at that time. Go ahead.
And endured the troubles of education.
See that? And endured the troubles of education. So the women do have a role to play. Teach them children. Teach them. You got sons, you're supposed to prepare them to be on the road to becoming men. Okay? Don't role switch. Don't gender play. Okay, the boy children are supposed to be prepared for us to take over after a while. I'm not running around with a 5-year-old. I mean, I play a little while, but after, the women are supposed to prepare their minds, learning these laws, to make them prepared and ready for the men to take over. That's how it was always done. That's how it was always done. Not, we don't want a little faggot boy coming around. Can I say that? Little homo boy.
Shalom.
I want some milk and cookies. The hell out of here. Then we're going to look at the woman. Woman, you ain't doing your damn job. Look what you brought me. A marshmallow kid. The hell is this? Tell a boy, go do some push-ups in a corner somewhere. Give him, yeah. The hell is this? Read that again.
And brought thee up unto this age and endured the troubles of education.
So you women, you got a job. You can't just throw your kids on us. I'm going to just bring my boy here. So here, you take him. No. You women, you ain't going to shuck your responsibilities. Your job is to raise them boys and them girls in their proper respective roles. I hope that, oh, but that's probably too much for some of them. I can't do it. It's too much for me. Here we go. Wait till your father get home. Boy run crazy through the house. Wait till your father get home. No! You snatch a little rug right behind up, whoop him, and sit him in the corner. And you make him write down them commandments 10, 15, 20 times. How about that? Gonna wait till I get home. I get home, everything burned down. Now I'm looking at her. She's like, well, I told him to wait till you get home. Simple as hell. You women want to know what your role is? That's one of your roles. Raise them children upright. Where we at now? Where we go? Okay, here we go. Here we go some more. Give me Proverbs 31:1. Hey, always get emails. What's our role?
Bishop, I had to, yeah, you know, like a lot of time, our sisters is so coolest. You know, like when you was in these kids up, then I heard the foolish thing I ever heard is just like, I tell them to do that, they didn't do it. But she's talking about a kid that is 2 years old. I told him to do that, he didn't do it. You talking about a kid that is 3 years old. I tell them he didn't do it. I tell him don't get in the top of that. That's showing you are coolest sisters. You better off, some sisters in this side, you better off just give your kids to the Edomite woman. I'm telling you straight.
Yeah, and the problem is some of y'all raise your own gods. Some of your kids are gods. That's another problem.
What do you mean by that?
Meaning that the child can't be corrected. The child can never do no wrong. That's another problem. That's that Eli spirit. Eli's sons were his gods too. The Lord killed him and his two sons and the entire generation of them all at once. So let that be a reminder as well.
And also the trouble of education goes in also in correcting your kid. Because sometimes dealing with them kids is not easy. Some sisters, y'all be scared to whoop your kids behind. Like me, my kids don't want me to deal with them because they know anytime I deal with them, it's different. Like the sisters, they going to get a belt and they going, you know, the kids and them, like when I was young, I used to laugh when my moms whooped me. You understand? But sometimes she couldn't even catch me. But you sisters got to be different with these kids, man. You understand? They gotta get that fear. You are the fear of the Most High in them to know if they do anything wrong, you're going to discipline them. You understand? That's where that goes back also into the trouble of education, because the education is also teaching them and bringing them up rightly in the Most High laws. You understand? So that's also some of the trouble.
Yeah, but then even though towards the father, like the bishop just said, when their father taking over, the father's supposed to, sister, you did a good job.
Right.
You understand? It's not supposed to. Damn, I got to work that. I have to work that too.
So, and that goes into knowing personality types. You women got to know the personality type. All children don't have the same personality type. Some kids you could talk nice to. Some kids you got to call fire from heaven and burn their ass up. Excuse me. That's some. You just got to know the spirits. Some kids are devious, tricky, tricksters. You got to know those spirits and how to deal with them. That's where the mama come in. Here go to my, I don't know what to do. You are ostrich.
If you understand the purpose of getting on that behind, then you won't have any problems doing what you have to do. Because if you don't step in and raise the child right, the child is going to make a fool out of everything. Might end up getting killed. Mm-hmm. Then your simple, stupid behind me talking about something, I wish I would have raised him right. Too damn late then.
Exactly.
Some of them be afraid to even speak rough to the kids. Talking about they're going to get their feelings hurt. I'd rather your feelings get hurt today than you be dead tomorrow.
There you go. Get that. Proverbs 31:1.
Proverbs 31:1.
Now, when you look up the King Lemuel, they say that was a nickname for Solomon, some books say. So his mother, listen good to what I'm saying, his mama is instructing him. Read.
The words of King Lemuel, the prophecy that his mother taught him. What my son, and what the sons of my womb. And what the sons of my vows.
Sons, and not sons.
The son of my vows. Give not thy strength unto women, nor thy ways to that which destroyeth kings.
She said, I'm going to teach you something, son. She said, I'm going to teach you about women, what to look for, what not to look for. And I'm going to teach you what it means to be a king. What? A woman? Yes, a woman is training Solomon in his infant stages what it means to be a king. Go ahead.
It is not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine, nor for princes strong drink.
Go ahead.
Lest they drink and forget the law and pervert the judgment of any of the afflicted.
So she started to give him a breakdown, a lesson. Now, this is not just one lesson, because you know, as parents, you can't tell a child one thing and they retain it. Memory comes through constant repetition. That's how you learn the commandments of the Most High. Recite it again. Write it down. Recite it again. Now write it down. So Mama was teaching Solomon about judgment, wine, women, and what it means to be a king. That's the woman's role, thus saith the Lord. She is to raise them boys right. Okay? Then she goes into a heavy subject. She said, now, the largest subject, let me tell you about women. No, the TV wasn't on. She said, let me tell you what kind of woman you need, what kind of woman you want, what kind of woman is necessary to help you in this walk. You need a virtuous woman.
You know you got a problem when the television is the loudest mouth in your house. That's when you really got a problem. When the most conversation is going on is the TV, you really got a mess. Mm-hmm.
You got the virtuous woman. Can we look up the word virtuous? Let me tell you something right now. The virtuous woman is not the American-minded woman at all. That's like the opposite side of the coin. I'm going to say it again in case they didn't understand what I said. The virtuous woman is not, N-O-T, the American-minded woman. Okay, this is it. Okay, here's virtuous, righteous, good, pure, saintly. And those are too deep. I mean, some easy ones. Okay, moral, ethical, upright, upstanding, high-minded. Let me see. Blameless, I like that. Guiltless, I like that. Honest, I like that. Honorable, reputable. Decent, that's an easy word for us. Worthy, noble, squeaky clean. I like that right there. So that's a virtuous woman. That's what y'all want in conjunction with God's commandments. That's what y'all want. That's what y'all need. And Solomon's mother had to teach him what a virtuous woman is. A virtuous woman is not an American woman, an American-minded woman. You ever notice sisters come from the island, Turner? They'll be nice as hell in the islands. When they come here, they turn into Beelzebub. You ever notice that? This is like a different woman. They got Americanized. I ain't got to give you food because in the islands, they all... Like when we went, who was with me in Jamaica? Remember them women? Very nice. I said, you know what? They are so nice, but they get over here in America, they ain't serving you nothing. They ain't have no TV. Some women get a problem with making sandwiches. I gotta make him a sandwich. What am I, a sandwich maker? Give me that in Luke 10. Can you give me that in Luke 10? 39-40. All I do is, I remember one sister that used to be with us. Her husband couldn't shut up, but she used to say, I envy you men. All I do is make sandwiches. You know what I'm talking about. All I do is make sandwiches. But y'all go out to the war, to the battle. I want to go out there with you. So, sister, please. What the hell are you? And y'all think I'm making it? I'm not. Can I tell you? Y'all something? No. Things that go in women's minds.
Y'all see the reason why we speak the way we speak, because we actually have real situations where this kind of stuff came up. And all that. It was unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Luke 10, verse 39 and 40. We're talking about Mary and Martha just for a second.
Luke 10, verse 39. And she had a sister.
Start a verse above it, 38. No, start at 37. Start at 37. Luke 10, 38.
Luke 10, verse 38. Now it came to pass, as they went, that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house.
So these were hospitable women.
Martha had a house. She said, Christ, come with me. Come chill in my house. All the disciples came with him. Go ahead.
And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving.
Martha was running around making sandwiches. Making sandwiches. That's what she was doing. Go ahead.
And came to him and he said,
and
Lord.
And
came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone?
She said, I'm doing all the serving by myself and my sister won't help me. Go ahead.
Bid her therefore that she help me.
Make her help me, Lord. Just make the woman just get up and help me serve these sandwiches. Go ahead.
And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her.
So now, what I want y'all to see out of that, it was customary for the women to take care of the men, but Christ said the main thing that I want everyone to see is that Mary wanted to learn. She wanted to know these scriptures, and that's good because you can't save the woman. She only give me that. Here's the proof. Give me that in Ezekiel 14. Is it 14? Come on, help me. And 20. You can't save nobody. Only her work's going to save her.
Ezekiel 14.
Now, we didn't read that for sisters to say, well, I ain't serving no sandwiches. That ain't the message. That ain't the message. Good. I know the Americanized woman, that's all she took out of that. I ain't got to serve nothing then. That ain't what that was saying. That's why I don't help. You sisters don't help, don't worry. God sees you. He said, you shall receive all that you give in his word. So you do nothing good for nothing, sisters. The Lord sees you too. Come on.
Though Noah, Ezekiel 14, verse 20. Though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter.
You can't save your sons. You brothers can't save your daughters. Go ahead.
They shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness.
You can only deliver your own souls by their righteousness. That goes for men and women. So you brothers, I think my woman, because you got dumb doctrines out there, the woman don't got to learn the Bible. She don't learn just make food. No. She got to learn too. She has a role to play in this truth. A big role. A heavy role. By her own righteousness. Okay? So, and that goes for the sisters that sit amongst us, and we know who y'all are. Believe me, we see y'all. Sisters that have been with us for years and do nothing. I mean nothing. They will just sit there. We see you. God sees you first and foremost. So we see it. So, but okay, let's let this ride. We're gonna see. Here you go to the next woman.
But Bishop, I often hear brothers quote, wives, submit yourselves to your husbands. Well, I got to submit myself to him. He ain't no good.
You do gotta submit yourselves to your husbands. Then she says, but I raised a good son. Some women say, I raised a son. He's a doctor. This son may be a lawyer. This son over here is about to retire. That's an American woman. We pay our bills. How do I apply this stuff? Or the woman says, oh, here, let me change. The woman says, she might be a doctor. She might be a lawyer. She might be an entrepreneur. Women like that. Let me get it right. Women like that who come into this truth in all praises. We need women like that. But guess what they have a hard time doing? Submitting themselves. Women come in, some are COs, correction officers, some are parole officers, some are police officers, and they come into the truth. Now, on those three jobs particularly, even lawyers, even doctors, them five professions there, women are in them professions. And they have to run stuff. Do this, do that, shut up, sit out. That's all fine. But when you come from the world back home, the woman has to learn to be, to what? Help me out here so I don't say the wrong thing. Submit herself according to scriptures. Because if she don't, is she going to get salvation? No. You ain't coming, you're not going to get saved running your mouth with your man, putting him under your foot like you do. You got to separate your job out there in the world to what you have in this truth.
And the Most High is not going to bend his Bible to appease your American mind either.
Exactly.
He's not going to bend the Bible.
Bishop.
You're going to get bent and broken.
Exactly.
Bishop, can I give you a scripture to back what you said?
Go ahead.
Sirach chapter 25, verse 23. The bishop spoke about that woman that tries to dominate her man. And the scripture has that documented. She takes pleasure in being the tough guy. And she wants to keep on the pants. Exactly. She's sunning them. She's telling them what to do.
What verse, Deacon?
Sirach 25, verse 23.
Sirach 25, verse 23. A wicked woman abateth the courage.
You know what it means to abate someone's courage? You're breaking them down. And there are some men that have come to us with a broken spirit because of their wife's dominant spirit. Read it again.
A wicked woman abateth the courage.
She takes away every ounce of manliness in him. He can't raise his voice. He can't make any of the decisions. He can't put himself in a position of authority. Because why? Read it again.
A wicked woman abateth the courage.
Read on.
Maketh an heavy countenance.
And every time you see him, his face looked depressed. He looked like he wanted to leave this truth. Because she's in a position of power over him. And she glories in that. That's why I always bring up the analogy of Adam and Eve in the garden. Satan approached her with a position of power. You don't have to listen to the Most High. You don't have to listen to your husband. You will be as a god. Read it again.
A wicked woman abateth the courage, maketh an heavy countenance, and a wounded heart.
Satan knew what he was doing by telling a woman, don't listen to your man and don't listen to the Most High. That's how you destroy a nation. Read on.
A woman that will not comfort her husband in distress.
Because this captivity is distress. And we don't need nobody with a big mouth screaming at us at the same time the white man in the other nations is screaming at us. We're in distress. Read on.
Maketh weak hands and feeble knees.
And that's why you got weak, undisciplined Negroes in the street. They're a product of just women from their mothers to the woman that they meet afterwards have destroyed them. They're nothing now before us.
So, let me help you sisters out. You sisters with these big jobs, you might make a six-figure income. That's good. You brothers want to look for women like that. Help you out. Let me help you women out, though. I'm going to help you. I am here to help you sisters like that in that predicament. There was a woman in Israel named Hadassah. Beautiful sister of the tribe of Benjamin. Yeah, it was Benjamin. I know you're shocked, but yeah, it was Benjamin. Lovely. So lovely that the king of Persia chose her to be queen by his side. Give me Esther, chapter 9. Let's see how Esther, Queen Esther, and that's the same name as Easter. That's the same name as Ashtaroth. That's where they changed her name from Hadassah to Esther. Esther chapter 9, verse 12 and 13.
Esther chapter 9.
Oh man, this Bible.
Verse 13.
Now this is right after the plot to kill off the Israelites that was in Persia, in Shushan. It was a Shushan.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Then said Esther, if it please the king, let it be granted to the Jews which are in Shushan to do tomorrow also according unto this day's decree. And let Haman's 10 sons be hanged upon the gallows.
So Queen Esther, she wasn't letting the nation slide who tried to murder her people. And it started with Haman. So she said, kill Haman, his sons, and let the Jews protect themselves. Read on.
And the king commanded it so to be done. And the decree was given at Shushan. And they hanged Haman, and they hanged Haman's 10 sons.
You know why this is heavy? Because when you look at our sisters today on the news, something happened to their sons. What is the first thing the Christian woman says when her sons was blasted to hell? I forgive them. What Bible are you reading? What Bible are you reading? Esther said kill them. Not just him, and kill all his kids too. That's how she used her power. Now, I'm going to jump down the same chapter. Jump down to verse 29 to 32, same chapter.
Verse 29. Then Esther, the queen, the daughter of Abihail, and Mordecai, the Jew, wrote with all authority to confirm this second letter of Purim.
They established a holiday. With her authority, and Mordecai established the holiday of Purim. Go ahead.
And he sent the letters unto all the Jews to the 127 provinces of the kingdom of Ahasuerus with words of peace and truth to confirm these days of Purim and their times appointed according as Mordecai the Jew and Esther the queen had enjoined them and as they had decreed for themselves and for their seed the matters of the fastings and their cry.
Come on.
And the decree of Esther confirmed these matters of Purim, and it was written in the book.
So what I want y'all to see with the role of the woman, they played a big role in Israel. For those of you who don't understand a woman plays a vital role, you don't know the Bible. You have just illustrated you don't know the Bible if you think the woman have no role in this nation. You are clueless. You are a caveman. The woman has a big role. So you women who have these certain particular jobs where you have power and authority, use your power to help your people. That's what Esther did. That is the example. You got all this authority, all this power, well, help your people now. That's what the other nations do. How come the black woman and the Latin woman get confused on that matter?
Hey, they use that power, Elder, to dominate their husband.
And that's right. That's out of order. That is out of order. Now, let's jump back to Proverbs 31 just for a second. Esther had a job to do. She did it. And she did it with such zeal and authority. Haman, y'all got to read the history with Esther. It's beautiful. She used her feminine qualities to get everything she wanted. She didn't go in there like gangbusters kicking doors down with the king. She used her feminine wiles. That's when it came into play. I'm going to shape what my mama gave me. I'm going to do what I got to do. And I'm going to save my race. That's what she did. Esther was bad. Watch this. Give me Proverbs 31. This is for the next group of sisters who come into the truth. And y'all struggling. How many brothers married in here? Raise your hand. Okay. How many brothers in here, your wife needs to work? Needs to work. Okay. A few of y'all. Y'all don't want to admit it, but that's fine. That is fine. Watch this. You live in an apartment. Some women go, I want a house. I want a white picket fence. I want a dog. I want this. I want that. I want 3 cars, 2 cars, whatever they want. But she don't got a job. Now, this ain't for the doctor sister. This ain't the lawyer sister. This ain't for them big money sisters. This is for the other sister who sit home and wait for you to get 2 and 3 jobs. To do certain things for them. Well, let's talk about the Proverbs, the virtuous woman that Solomon's mama told him to look for.
So, wait a minute, Bishop. So, the woman is putting the pressure on him.
Yes.
She ain't doing anything.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to think about doing 2 or 3 jobs. You know what you're going to say to yourself? Well, I can sell dope and I can make the money with just doing a couple of runs for Big T on the corner. And I ain't got to deal with the 2 or 3 jobs. Mm-hmm. Then you're behind, go to jail.
Exactly. Let's read 13 down.
Then she going with somebody else.
Proverbs 31, verse 13.
Now remember, Solomon's mother is telling him this is the type of woman to look for. Go ahead.
She seeketh wool.
Now, somebody, right? I know what somebody's thinking, but he was the king. She didn't have to work. You're right. So this is really a similitude for us today. Because Solomon's wife didn't, because he was the richest man. She didn't have to do nothing. So what we're about to read is really for you black and Latin women today. Come on with it.
She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands.
She does what?
And worketh willingly with her hands.
Oh, no. She sits there and watched TV, Atlanta Housewives. On Facebook all day. Running the bill up. Read.
And worketh willingly with her hands. She is like the merchant ship
She bringeth her food from afar.
Uh-huh.
She riseth also while it is yet night, and giveth meat to her household, and a portion to her maidens.
Go ahead.
She considereth a field, and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hands, she planteth a vineyard.
So this virtuous woman, which is the woman all you brothers need to look for, is a woman that's willing to get down and dirty with you. Get down and work with you. Understand that. You brothers want that hasididdy sister who sit around with her nails did all day. Look at my nail. And meanwhile, you got bags on top of bags under your eyes because you're working 2 and 3 jobs, working 15, 20 hours a day. And she's sitting there, well, you supposed to do that. This ain't the kingdom. Can you give me that in Tobit now when he got blind? You better find a soul. The message that Solomon's mama told him, which is a message God is telling us, find a woman with some skills. Find a woman that know how to do something. Don't look for that. I tell y'all looking for that video vixen who can't do nothing but make it shake. That only lasts for 6 months, brothers. After the 6 months, you where you told her?
And listen, Bishop, she got a secret bank account you don't know about.
Exactly.
She got her own savings.
And the bank account, the other dude know about it. Her and the other dude know about it.
I don't know what y'all stop talking about. Liam, did you find it for me?
No, looking for
it. I got to help him out because he said he don't know what I'm talking about.
I found it.
Tobit 2, verse 11.
Okay, Tobit 2, verse 11.
And my wife Anna did take woman's work.
Wait. Tobit had a virtuous wife. Can we read about his wife Anna one more time?
And my wife Anna did take woman's work to do.
You see what the virtuous woman did? Went out and did woman's work. Went out and helped pay the bills. You see, that's a virtuous woman right there. But meanwhile, some of y'all on Facebook, y'all looking for that glamour queen. Watch out for them glamour queen sisters that's about makeup 101. That's all she about. I look pretty, don't I look pretty? Look at me. Look. That's what they do. That's all they about. That will wear off. Wait till age start to creep in. She started 20 years. She look good at 20. I mean, she gonna look, if you love her, she gonna look good, whatever. But she's that vain sister. And you, some of y'all look for that vain sister. Then we get the calls because you're mad. She don't do nothing. I'm tired. Now she want to have sex. I work 20 hours. I'm tired. I don't want to have sex. All she did was sit home and do her nails and got her hair did. You get sick of that after a while. You say, what the hell is this? Get out there and do something to help us. Then you got the daughter looking at her. Mama, don't work. I ain't going to work either. See what she's training up? A little, ostrich who can't help nobody, can't help herself. Now, what happened when daddy gets sick? Daddy's sick and bedridden for, let's say, 3 months. What happens now, brothers? You're going to die because that woman, that Hasididdy woman, can't do, she can't pay bill one. What is the light bill? I don't know what that is. Oh, look, there's a new nail polish I bought. Look at this color. And you in the bedroom, I need medicine, sister. Get me some medicine. She can't, she has no skill. She has no understanding to do nothing. Y'all wasting your time with someone, I'm telling you. You, when y'all meet a sister, excuse me. I'm telling you, you better find out what's up there in that spirit.
Yeah, Bishop, you know that sisters have all the time in the world. So search out things that the white men hide from us as men. You have to say hide some jobs within how he deal with this media. But sisters have times. But you notice that their time where they spin on. Either the new show, either show they already. If you have a sister who watch House, what's the thing, Housewife? I had the time to watch that thing one time. If a sister watched 3 episodes, a sister mind ain't right. I'm telling you straight. If their sister watched 3 of them, their sister mind ain't right. I'm telling you. Any sister that watched that thing too, I have a time to watch it one time. That thing was so demonic to me, I just let it go. If any sister, you find yourself 1, 2, 3, sister, don't kill, what's the word? Don't be real to yourself. Your mind ain't right. Period. You still of the American mind.
Mm-hmm. Now the next sister that women, American women, run to is Deborah. Let's get in Judges 5 and let's see about her qualities. This is for the religious sister. Watch those sisters that love to quote scriptures on Facebook. Those are the biggest hypocrites. They quote, 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 and they don't do. I'm telling you. Judges 5, 7 to 9, about Deborah. She was a prophetess, brother, and she was running things. She was over the men, brother. You don't know, brother. Y'all crazy. Now, when we were coming up in the truth, I don't know if you remember this, Yahwasop, there was a camp of women led by a sister, a black demon named Deborah. And she would go out with a sword. Yeah, I'm not joking. Her, she had about five sisters with her, wearing white all the time, and she had a sword saying she was the prophetess Deborah. That was a demon. She had a very, she had a demise. She ended. It ended. She was ended. Being out on the streets ain't no joke, sisters. It ain't no joke. But I'll end it there. Where'd I say go?
Judges 5, verse 7.
Go ahead.
The inhabitants of the village ceased.
Now, this is Deborah speaking. Go ahead.
They ceased in Israel until that I, Deborah, arose. That I arose a mother in Israel.
Y'all know what it is to be a mother. It's an honor. When you read the scriptures throughout all nations, it was always honorable for women to become mothers. You don't start off as a mother. You might be a mother, but you don't start off as a mother. You go from daughter to wife to mother. That was a high thing. But here in America, they say no. And it's always that college woman that says no, the college sister, no. I can't be no mother, not no. I was reading an article with what's her name? Dark-skinned sister, dang, what's her name? Not Jackie. Name some actresses for me. Not Gabrielle Union. Older sister. Older. Angela Bassett. Thank you, brother. Lovely sister. She said she don't want no babies because it's going to mess up her body, going to mess up her career. So now they're doing artificial insemination, all that foolishness with other women. It was an honor, and it shall be so again for women to be a mother. And a mother in the context of Titus that we read about, in the context of Maccabees that we read about, in the context of the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31 that we read about. Back to Judges.
Until that I, Deborah, arose, that I arose a mother in Israel.
Go ahead.
They chose new gods. Then was war in the gates.
So she was getting on Israel. She said Israel chose new gods. And then there was war in the gates because God rose up our enemies against us. Go ahead.
Was there a shield or spear seen among 40,000 in Israel? My heart is toward the governors of Israel that offered themselves willingly among the people. Bless ye the Lord.
Now, verse 9 is the verse that these women don't like to read. As soon as they mention Deborah, she did this. Verse 9, sister, she says, my heart, meaning my mind, is toward the governors. Meaning she was what, brothers? In order. In order. Like it says in Corinthians, God, Christ, man, woman, Deborah was in order. As great as she was, and she was great, she was in order. She was not running around doing whatever the hell she want to do. Go ahead.
Did she say that I'm a father to Israel? Is that what Deborah said? She said, I'm a mother, so who are the fathers? You just read them in verse 9. Read verse 9 again.
My heart is toward the governors of Israel.
Those are the fathers. So she was in subjection, like a mother is, to the fathers. So that's the order. Don't let them fool you with that feminist lesbian spirit. That's what it is. Yep. It's a feminist lesbian spirit when you hear that come out the woman's mouth.
Read it one more time.
My heart is toward the governors of Israel that offered themselves willingly among the people.
When she said her heart, what does her heart mean? Her mind. Her mind was on the men. She was on what can I do to support the troops? And that's what y'all missing there. The Most High sent her prophets, visions, understanding. She said, this is to assist the men. Mm-hmm. Okay, exactly. So whenever you read about the prophets in the scriptures, they will bring the visions to help the men out.
Exactly.
Exactly. As a prophetess, when she saw a vision, she was able to let Barak know, bring the men to the east side because the adversary is back there, meaning she was able to see things in advance. So she helped Barak in leading the troop. I mean, she was the leader. She was telling him what she saw in the spirit. That's what she was beneficial to.
And Bishop, I'll give you an even heavier one than that. There's a lot of women today who have dreams. We used to have women around us who used to have dreams. Remember that, Bishop? That's no longer with us. They will always come in and tell us their dreams, but they would use their dreams for wickedness. Just like when you read in Acts, you had a woman that she said her dreams brought her masters much gain. She was using her dreams for wickedness. Okay, the sisters who, you have power on the right-hand side of God and power on the left-hand side of God. And the woman on the right-hand side of God, they're going to use the understanding they have to better their people. That's why you got a lot of women in witchcraft, brujeria, spirits, they see things. I know a lot of women who will always talk about, I had a dream. And it was in witchcraft. They was in wickedness. The Most High got righteous women who they are called prophetess, that they use their visions for the betterment of their people.
Exactly. And let me tell you something. Deborah didn't have to call her. When you look at the prophetesses in the Bible, like Miriam and Deborah, for example, they didn't have to call themselves prophetess. The people called them prophetess. When you see a woman say, I'm a prophetess, watch that one right there. Watch that one. She a demon. Because whatever gift she got, everybody going to see it's going to come through. You ain't got to open your mouth and say nothing. It's going to be evident. Watch this. Give me Luke 8. Still talking about the woman. That's right. I'm still talking about you. Luke 8, 1 to 3.
What is my role in Israel? What do I got to do?
Okay. We've been hitting on it. Hope you women been taking notes. Luke 8, 1 to 3.
Luke chapter 8, verse 1. And it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him, and certain women which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went 7 devils, and Joanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward.
So her husband worked in the palace. Okay, like he worked, he was the steward of the house under Herod. Go ahead.
And Susanna, and many others, which ministered unto him of their substance.
So these women followed Christ. They loved Christ in the 12. They loved these women, loved them, and followed them, and provided all the help they could for them. So women, you don't know what you got to do. Here's an example. Provide us with your substance. Help us in this truth. There's a lot of work that needs to go down. Watch this. Philippians 4 and 3. Philippians. Philippians, come on.
Philippians 4, verse 3. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel.
You hear what Paul said? He said there was women that helped him, labored with him in this gospel, in this work. He said, help them. Don't forget those sisters. Showing you more proof that women did play a part, do play a part in this work. Go from there. Get me Romans 16, 1 through 4.
Romans 16, verse 1.
Watch this.
I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is at Chantrea, that ye receive her in the Lord as becometh saints, and that you assist her in whatsoever business she hath need of you. For she had been a succorer of many, and of myself also.
So Phoebe, this was a sister of good works. She knew about business. Paul said, help that sister. She has been a comfort to me in this work. So I want you brothers to get your minds right. Come out of caveman. Come out. Now women, don't take anything that we're reading to mean that you are running the men. Because I know that American nigger woman. Oh, I gotta run the man. That's how her mind instantly goes there to feminism. If that's what you, we're gonna throw you right up on your behind out the door. Because that ain't what none of these scriptures are saying. Read on.
Verse 3. Greet Priscilla and Aquila,
husband and wife,
my helpers in Christ Jesus.
Go ahead.
Who have for my life laid down their own necks.
This husband and wife laid down their lives for this gospel. Don't exclude the sister, the wife was with them. Go ahead.
Unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles.
Meaning the churches of the scattered Israelites. Okay, jump down to verse 6.
Verse 6. Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor on us.
Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor on us. Jump down from there. Go to verse 20. Verse 12.
Salute Tryphena and Tryphosa.
Tryphena and Tryphosa were twin sisters. They were twins. Go ahead.
Who labored in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persis, which labored much in the Lord.
So what I want y'all to see, I'm just hitting these scriptures primarily for you sisters to understand. You want to know what you got to do? You got to do a lot of work, not just sit there on your behinds. Help us in this work, okay? From there, give me Acts 13 and 50.
Acts 13, verse 50. But the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable woman. And so, But the Jews stirred up the devout and honorable woman and the chief men of the city and raised persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them out of their coast.
What I want you to see that in the congregation of Israel, this is the ones that were rejecting Christ, but they were still, it says honorable women. That's what I want you to see. They were always honorable women. Jump to Judges chapter 17 and verse 4.
Acts 17, verse 4. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks, a great multitude, and of the chief women, not a few.
So you had chief women in the congregation, okay? Get me Acts 1:14. We've read this one many times. Acts 1:14.
Acts 1, verse 14. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the woman.
With who?
With the woman.
So that's New Testament for you. That's why I want everybody to get the cobwebs out of their head. Okay? I want you women to start helping us in this truth. We're going to a new level. Okay? A new level where a lot of work needs to be done. We don't need no bickering. We don't need no gossiping. We don't need no, give me some more stuff we don't need.
Backbiting.
Backbiting.
Jealousy.
We don't need no foolishness.
Stupid emails.
Right. We don't need none of that.
Can we stay right where we was?
Yeah.
Because a lot of you are worried if we speak this way, then the woman won't come here and they won't come back or they'll get upset. Because that's what a lot of people think. That's why a lot of these Christian pastors, they speak to keep the women in the church.
Right. They cater to the woman.
They cater to them. But understand this. Read, just go to this one section in Acts chapter 5, verse 14. This is what we know that they don't know because they're teaching garbage.
Acts 5, verse 14. And believers were the more added to the Lord.
Say it again.
And believers were the more added to the Lord.
If the woman believes, nothing is going to chase her away. She's not going to be offended. Read on.
Multitudes, both of men and women.
So we know that there's going to be believing women who are going to hear this and add to where the Most High's word is coming from. So we're not speaking in a manner like, are you offended? Please don't get mad. If you don't like it, get out.
Get out. Get out.
Get out. I tell people all the time, you don't like what you're hearing online? There's a whole laundry list of Israelite caps waiting to get inside your pants, waiting to have sex with your children, waiting to take your paycheck. We're in a disrespect you and make. Go ahead, go to them.
Exactly.
There was a sister who called Deacon Malachi. And she called Deacon Malachi. She told Deacon Malachi that I'm just calling you guys because I don't like the way you're bringing these scriptures out. Deacon Malachi's answer to her was, are you calling me to tell me what to do? Or are you calling me because you need help? Cloop. That was a hang up.
But you know, that's the same spirit that we talked about in the beginning. She felt empowered enough to call and say something like
that. Right, because the white man, the devil, has given them authority. I'm going to get you to do my will. No, that don't work like that. Give me Ecclesiastes, Sirach, chapter 34. Remember, the kingdom of heaven is within you, men and women. Starting with the men, and the women going to follow our lead. Then we're going to get the kingdom. We have the keys to the kingdom. Just be patient. Bear with us. Okay, there's a great work the Most High needs to get done. And it's going to get done with or without you. Sirach 34.
What verse?
23.
Sirach 34, verse 23. When one buildeth...
Listen good, because we're on a mission to build. This, what the Most High got our hands doing, brothers and sisters, we are about building. We are about bringing forth the kingdom of heaven, like Christ said. It don't come with observation. It's within you. You got to build it. You got to start the foundation. That's what we're doing. When one buildeth...
And when one buildeth, another pulleth down. What profit have they then but labor?
So if we're building and you got a knucka with us trying to tear down, that's that sister or that brother gossiping. Oh, look at that one over there. He ain't right. She ain't right. You know what? We should leave. Get the hell out. Because spirits like that are here. You put a brick up the bill. Here she might come behind you, take the brick down.
That goes.
Some of you brothers win marriages like that. You're trying to keep the marriage together. Here she come. She don't know what to do.
That's that abating the courage that Deacon Asa have read earlier.
Exactly.
Same thing, same spirit.
Or vice versa. Here we are trying to build something, and it may be a brother. You put the brick up, he going to come behind you, take it down.
Exactly.
We can't have you like that.
And
you
Bishop,
need to join. Hey, there's a dirty camp on 34th Street. Go have fun. Go. We got two doors. We ain't holding nobody back with us. Go ahead.
And Bishop, he got that spirit from his mama.
Exactly.
Okay, most of the time you got Negroes like that who can't play well with others. Mm-hmm. It's because they're undisciplined and their mama raised them.
Exactly.
Okay, because the man instilled discipline inside you. He make you think before you do things. So every time you got brothers who come in here that can't work well with others or has that me spirit or I'm better than you, that's that. He got that same Jezebel spirit from his mother. Men can carry that Jezebel spirit too.
Get Proverbs 14, verse 1. Proverbs 14 and verse 1.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You got the should do it. Do this in her house. Should do it to this house too.
Yep. We got a lot of them on Facebook.
Yep. And YouTube is individual lights. That's what I call them. Individual lights. That's
right. They
lonely individuals. Lights. Individual lights. All the same.
The lonely lights.
Proverbs 14 verse 1. Every wise woman buildeth her house.
Every wise woman encourages her husband. She's supportive. She's a pillar of rest. Not a pillar of pest. A pillar of rest. That's what a wise woman is. Go ahead.
But the foolish plucketh it down with her hands.
But the foolish woman plucks it down with her hands. She's destructive. She wants things to be destroyed. Low self-esteem. She's American-minded, so she'll destroy her own house and the house that we're trying to build here.
Right.
So you're not needed here.
That's the woman, for example, that will get in an argument with you, mm-hmm. call the cops on you, you get arrested, locked up, lose your job. She ain't working, mind you. Lose your job. Then she go, I'm sorry. Now you ain't got a job. You have no means to support, and you look at her dumb behind. Like, just a stupid woman I got here.
I don't know what to do. What are we going to do?
Going to a shelter. Thank you. Thank you. Give me Ecclesiastes 9:18. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 18. That's like, you saw Rosewood? Remember, what's the big woman's name? Esther Rowe. She knew the Edomite had raped the woman. She didn't say nothing. The whole town was getting murdered. Every black man and woman was getting strung up, burnt, shot. She's sitting in, I ain't going to say nothing. I'm just so holy. Till the end, here she go. I'm just going to tell the truth now. Well, thank you. Thank you. We all dead now. Thank you.
She got shot after.
And that was a true story, too. You got it for me?
Ecclesiastes 9, verse 18.
Write that down.
Wisdom is better than weapons of war.
So, brothers, understand that. And the wisdom is talking about is the scriptures. It's better than your Glock, than your knife. Wisdom is better than weapons of war. Go ahead, watch this.
But one sinner.
But one nigger.
Destroyeth much good.
Will destroy much good. That's what he's talking about. That sinner, that uncooperative, undisciplined person, it could be male or female, will destroy everything. Well, that's why we got to be. Y'all must be the eyes and ears for us. Because we don't hear everything or know what's going on with y'all. To let us know who's saying what so we can get rid of that sinner.
That sounds like that line from that movie. That man said, you know the damage one ignorant Negro can do.
Exactly.
Bishop, exactly what you said the nigga hates. And the Most High has an order where the angels are reporting back to him. Yep. And you dumb niggas say, don't tell nobody. Yep. Snitches get stitches. Yep. The Most High got the best snitches on the face of the planet. They see everything you're doing and they carry it right back to the Lord because they don't want us to destroy what the Most High has in place. They tell you the Most High's eyes are 10,000 times brighter than the sun. He ain't watching everything. He got his angels going to and fro with a report every single day. And I'm stressing this because you got a wicked, demonic Israelite camp mad because we tell y'all to be our eyes and ears and let us know what's going on when you have wicked around you because they control their men. Don't say nothing.
Yeah, we pray that you've been writing scriptures down. You know why we pray you write scripture down? Because when we do enter to the new building, the bishop just warned you. It's a class of warning. Then I hope you'll write it down because we're not going to play around with none of y'all. I hope you'll write every scriptures down.
Watch this, Haggai chapter 1. The Most High is serious about when Christ said the kingdom of heaven is within you. When Christ said the kingdom of heaven does not come with observation to say lo here or lo there. He meant that thing. That's why when you read throughout the Old Testament, they were serious about building what they had to build. And of course, we know it was temporary. Well, brother, why are you going to build something? The missiles is coming. That's right. This, what we're doing is greater than any physical thing. This is more so spiritual, and it's going to translate to physical on the other side. The Most High is trying our hearts, trying our spirits. Watch this, Haggai 1, 4 through 7.
Haggai chapter 1, verse.
Where's Haggai? Somebody help me.
After Zephaniah.
Thank you.
You know what, Bishop? That's a dumb statement that somebody would say. Why build? Because the missiles are coming. Yeah. That's almost saying, like, you know what? Why go shopping for next week?
Yeah. Exactly.
Because the missiles might come tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Remember at the old school, they used to tell us, certain brothers said, don't get a job, don't go to college, because Christ is coming back. And them same brothers are living with regret upon regret.
Big time.
Big time.
Bishop, some of them are still saying it today.
Yes.
They got bums in their congregation telling them, don't go to school, don't get a good job, just get just enough to get by.
Watch this. Haggai 1, 4 through 7. This is to let you know how serious it was back then and how serious it is today. When Christ said the kingdom of heaven is within you and it does not come with observation, he meant that. Because blacks and Latinos, we like to sit back and let other people do this work. Watch this.
Haggai chapter 1, verse 4. Is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste?
Now, let me fill it in. You had Zerubbabel, and you had Joshua, the high priest. They were going through so many obstacles to rebuild the temple, they gave up. They said, you know what, maybe it's not the time. So they stopped building. So the Most High rose up Haggai. He rose up Zechariah and Zephaniah. He said, blast them. Put them on blast and get them to go back out there and build. So this is what Haggai is getting on them about. Read it again.
Is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways.
So how does that translate to us today? Many of us are busy trying to build our own personal homes, our own personal houses. We hear many speeches. I got this, I got all that's good, brother. But what does the kingdom of God have? Nothing. So now it comes to us. Christ said, listen, I'm telling you, don't think I'm going to come out the sky and just do everything for you. Y'all better get off your butts and work. So we're working now. This camp right here, we're about building things. We're about motivation, okay? We're about application. Progress. That's what we're about. Until the missiles come. And then it's going to be game on again. It ain't going to be over when the missiles come. Okay, read on.
Verse 6, you have sown much and bring in little.
So much meaning you worked, you did a lot of work in your vineyard. It says you have sown much and bring in little. Go ahead.
Ye eat, but ye have not enough.
Uh-huh.
Ye drink, but you are not filled with drink. Ye clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes.
So that's a curse on us. He said, you're so busy with your personal lives. He said, I'm going to put a plague on you spiritually. You're going to work and work and not have enough in your personal life. Why? Because God's work is not being done. I will command y'all to gather the 12 tribes of Israel. Gather Israel together, build a temple, build Jerusalem back. You have not done it. So this is a plague on us. So now here we are today. Christ said, gather the 12 tribes of Israel. Do this work. Have places for them to come together. Why you got to have a place for them to come together? So we can worship, so we can fellowship.
So, Bishop, he was instructing them to rebuild the temple so they could come together.
Yes.
He didn't tell them stay on a street corner.
Exactly.
Stay on a street corner and keep speaking to the people in the freezing cold, right, in the rain.
Exactly.
You see how stupid some people,
yep,
are?
Exactly.
The Most High got on them because he wanted a place built for them to go and fellowship.
Exactly.
Okay, but you have bums that said, no, 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 the Most High don't need a place,
right,
of fellowship. Come to this dusty corner right here where a white man could chase you off at any time. And if they chase us off here, we'll just move to a new location.
Right.
We'll just go to another location.
Exactly. Read.
Go. Thus said the Lord, ye look for much. Verse 9. Ye look for much.
We were six or seven.
Verse 7. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord.
So it says, consider your ways. That verse, what verse was that? Verse 7. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. He wants us to consider our ways. What is our goal in life? Is it the American dream or is it the kingdom of heaven? Everybody says that, but our actions prove otherwise. Many of our actions prove that our goal is the American dream. That's where all our time, our efforts, our monies, our thoughts is in America, their crafts. But in Israel, it's very little, very little. So, from there, give me 1 Corinthians 3, 8 and 9. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 8 and 9. You know what? You could be in the world. Well, I'm going to show you. Watch this. Consider this. When we're in the world, we'll get mad at something, but does our agenda change? Like, let's say you're on a job. You're mad at your boss. Do you walk off? No, because many of you have bills to pay. You stay right there. You endure whatever you endure, right, to do what you got to do in this world. But in Israel, guess what happened when a brother or a sister gets mad? Guess what they do? I'm leaving. I'm out. So that's what you hear everywhere. The kingdom of heaven. Yeah, right. I've been here 25 years. I've seen a lot of come, seen a lot of go. Soon as correction comes, I'm out. But the white man can correct you all day from sun up to sun. Yazza, Bowser. Yazza. And you shuckling energy. All of that cooning.
That's what I was thinking. I said, everybody be like, yeah, the kingdom of heaven is our goal. A lot of everybody don't believe that.
That's right.
Everybody do not believe that.
That's right. They say they believe, but in their act, Christ said, you shall know them by their fruits.
And I'm thinking about the history, how our people fought to get the temple set up, mm-hmm, and to go through the things that we're reading about. They fought with pure vigor. If anybody even thought to get in the way, heads was coming off.
That's right.
Because they understood how important it was to get that thing established.
Hey, they said, Nehemiah said they had a brick in one hand,
right,
and a sword in the other.
They were killing people that was trying to stop them.
Exactly. Because they was about nation time. Marshall used to always say to them, what time is it, brothers? Nation time. I used to love that thing.
I'm going to mention this. When we was at the men's conference, remember the brother that stood up, that his name was Gedaliah, the brother that had the heart attack?
Yes.
And he gave he spoke about how excited, his first words when he came up out of when he was in the hospital, he said that he was glad to be in this truth. I can't remember.
He said,
exactly.
I've never been a weak Jew. Deacon Abiel's
song.
Right,
right. He sang that song. Right, coming out of waking up from being in a heart attack. Heavy thing. Everybody was clapping and all of that. And at the same time, we had discussed how you have traitors that sit among us that spread discord. Yep. And I said that, and I made the statement. I said, well, if y'all really, because everybody clapped when the brother said what he said. Everybody clapped. It was like, yeah, we with you and all that. I said, well, okay, if y'all really love this brother the way we clapping, if we hear any nigga say anything against this truth, to bring it down, that means you're not respecting what this man, what the Lord brought him back to do. Mm-hmm. Y'all get my point? So if we have anybody among us that's talking about doing anything detrimental for realizing the kingdom, like what we're trying to do, and y'all don't say nothing, that means your applause was BS.
And that same night, we had to throw a nigga out.
Exactly.
Because he started saying, we don't got to be at peace with the white man. We could go out there and do what we want to him. I said, you kidding? Get all the brothers jacked up and throw that nigga out. Throw him out. Trying to get everybody jacked up and in jail.
I want y'all to understand what I'm saying. If we sit here and we allow anyone, any spirit, to say or do anything against this mission, you're basically saying that you hate those men and those women who's working to set this thing up.
Exactly. I want y'all to understand this. Read on. 1 Corinthians 3. Watch this, men.
1 Corinthians.
And you women, listen good.
1 Corinthians 3, verse 8. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one.
Right. We in one spirit. Paul was talking about him and Apollos. Okay. That goes for us and goes for you. One man plants, another man watereth. Go ahead.
And every man
here
shall.
Come, and every man shall.
Receive his own reward according to his own labor.
So you brothers going to receive your own reward according to your own labors. Whatever department you're in, if it's original royalty, if it's the video department, if it's the music department, you're going to receive, or if it's just going on the street teaching, we're all going to receive a reward based upon our own labor. I want everybody to understand that. You're not going to sneak in and get a reward. God, he's not stupid like that. He's not the white man. You ain't getting over on him. You're going to get rewarded according to your own labor. Next verse.
For we are laborers together with God.
That's unity. Solidarity. So now Paul comes back and says, we are laborers together. So whatever office you hold in this truth, and you're going to get your reward for what you do, we're still working together. We're still laboring together to bring forth the kingdom of heaven, which is within you. Go ahead.
Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building.
We are God's planting. That's what husbandry means. And ye are God's building. Go to chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians. Chapter 15, verse 58.
1 Corinthians 15, 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable.
So in this truth, all of us, brothers, sisters, we got to be steadfast in this truth, unmovable. Don't let nothing move you out this truth. Don't let your emotions move you out. Don't let a harsh word move you out. Don't let the sucking of a teeth move you out. Be unmovable. Go ahead.
Always abounding in the work of the Lord.
Always be about God's work. Always be about this work because there's nothing greater. Go ahead.
For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord.
Your labor is not in vain in the Lord. I want everybody to understand that. Now go to chapter 16 and verse 14 to 16.
1 Corinthians 16, verse 14. Let all your things be done with charity.
Charity means brotherly love. Let all things be done with brotherly love. Go ahead.
I beseech you, brethren, ye know the house of Stephanus, that it is the first fruits of Achaia.
To be the first fruits of Achaia means the first believers in that city. Go ahead.
And that they have addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints.
That's the only addiction that should be in here. It should not be an addiction to porn, not an addiction to cigarettes or weed, marijuana. It should be an addiction to this work because this is about a nation.
To be addicted, that means you are obsessed with it.
That's right.
That means it's on your mind all the time.
A fanatic.
That's what it means. So ain't no such thing as that you brothers are too serious about that Bible. There's no such thing as that according to the Most High. You're supposed to be addicted.
That's right. Read on.
That ye submit yourselves unto such.
So he says, submit yourselves to those brothers that are addicted to this ministry. Go ahead.
And to everyone that helpeth with us.
And submit yourselves to everyone that helpeth with us. Go ahead.
And laboreth.
And laboreth. So when you read the gospel, it's always been about laboring. Laboring. Laboring in this work. Give me Hebrews 6 and 10. Wait, jump down to 19 real quick. Jump down to 19.
Verse 19. The churches of Asia salute you. Aquila and Priscilla salute you much in the Lord.
What I want y'all to see, there were congregations throughout Asia, which is Asia Minor. Then it said you had churches that were in people's houses. That's how many of them started, in people's house. As it got too big, guess what? They couldn't stay in somebody's house all the time. As the numbers multiply, they had to step out of that. These men was in my house, some of these men. They said, listen, y'all got to get up out of here. Israel's getting too big now. We're growing. That should be common sense for a black man, black woman. But I don't know. Sometimes it ain't.
How could you expect to have a congregation in your house forever? Then what's the purpose of you gathering?
Exactly.
The whole purpose is for the body to grow.
Right. Labor.
Labor. To build the kingdom.
Exactly. I hope
y'all tell you, some of these brothers, I don't understand. It's the pure Satan.
Yeah. Hebrews 6 and 10. Watch this. Hebrews 6 and 10.
Hebrews 6 and 10. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love.
Y'all see that? Some of y'all think you do this work and it's going to be in vain. It's not going to be in vain. Paul reminded Israel, he said, God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love. Labor of love, like we read earlier, do all things with charity. That's that brotherly love. You love this truth. You love the brotherhood. You love this nation. You love your people. So the Most High ain't going to forget that. He see what you're doing in his work. That's why I said, you sisters that sit around and just scratch, you will get no reward. Because you just say, I ain't going to do nothing. I won't even get that nigga a glass of water. You will get no reward when the Savior returns. So don't think anybody's going to slip by. You brothers the same way. If you just sitting around humming and think you're going to get it, you're not going to get a reward. You're not. Read.
Which he has showed toward his name.
Uh-huh.
And that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister.
That's what the Lord is looking for. Read the whole verse in its entirety.
For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have showed toward his name.
You ain't showing it towards us. Some of y'all do certain things. I'm not going to do it because it's for him, that black nigga up there. It ain't for me. You ain't do nothing y'all do is for me. Everything that we do in this truth is for the Lord. It's for that kingdom of heaven to come forth, for Israel to repent, come into this truth, and be saved.
Right. That labor of love is like just like what you said, it's for this truth. Some may come in and do the labor and it be for their own personal thing, mm-hmm. for preeminence is one. They want to be looked upon as like they're working and then complaining.
Right.
Because they're jockeying for position and stuff like that. That ain't no labor of love. That's labor of the devil.
That's true, y'all. What's up? Because you got some brothers that come in here hot like fire. Right. And as soon as they get a woman or they move or a job or whatever, they ain't doing nothing for this truth no more. Exactly. You can't get them to do nothing. So they came in for a minute that way, but they ain't still carrying it out to the end. So the Most High going to forget them. That's why that scripture that said, you got your reward already. Right. Exactly. Okay, you got your reward. There's nothing more for you.
Exactly. Read that again, verse 10. I'm sorry.
For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love.
What I want y'all to see is those key words, work and labor. Work and labor. This truth is not about, like I was saying, this ain't the Christian church where you just sit back and look and clap and play the tambourine. It's about working. This is about work. That's what Christ said. The kingdom of heaven is within you. Bring it out. Go ahead.
Which ye have showed toward his name. In that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister.
Read.
And we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end.
Notice, and we desire that every one of you, that's men and women, do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. Do this work unto the end, brothers, sisters. Do this work unto the end. Read.
That ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises.
Oh, look at that beginning of verse 4. That ye be not, what's that word?
Slothful.
Brothers, what's that word?
Slothful.
That ye be not slothful. Meaning, don't be lazy about this work. Don't be half-hearted about this work. Go ahead.
But followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises.
All right. From there, we're almost done. Luke 17, 33. Luke 17, 33.
Luke 17, verse 33. Whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it. and whosoever shall lose his life shall preserve it.
Now I'm going to explain something to you about that verse. We just read that in the book of Haggai. We just read that in the book of Haggai. Literally, right. Where the men were more concerned with their personal life than the kingdom. That's what Christ, this is Christ speaking right here. Read it again.
Whosoever shall seek to save his life.
How do you seek to save your life? You're about your own personal careers, your own personal life. You're trying to save your American life. That's what Christ is talking. During this time, it was Rome. Now it's America, though. Go ahead.
Because you can't serve two masters. You gotta serve one or the other.
Exactly. Go ahead.
And whosoever shall lose his life shall preserve it.
Meaning, many of us came in this truth. We had goals. We had certain careers we wanted. And we knew if we followed it, it would interfere with this work. Many of us gave up those goals, those dreams, those aspirations. Not that we couldn't succeed, but we knew in the long end it would keep us from this. So we gave them things up. We came into this truth. That's what it means when it says, read that bottom precept again.
And whosoever shall lose his life.
We lost our life in this world. Go ahead.
Shall preserve it.
We're trying to preserve our life. Because why? We want to do this work. Okay. From there, give me Sirach 38:34. Sirach in Apocrypha. Ecclesiastes 38:34. Right.
And Bishop, what's good with that scripture is it shows you're going to have to take losses to build a kingdom. Because a lot of y'all think y'all going to come into the kingdom unscathed, untouched. Y'all going to come in intact. You're going to come in with bruises, bumps, scrapes, meaning the trials that you go through. Y'all going to take losses to come into the kingdom. It says, through much tribulation shall you enter the kingdom. And some of y'all, as soon as a little bit of tribulation come, you run like the coward that you are.
The Apostle Paul counted those losses as dung.
Dung. That's what he said. He gave up everything.
Exactly. So those of you that want to, what did it say?
Preserve your life.
The first part. Save your life in this world. That's the part I wanted. Those of you that want to save your life in this world, you want your spouse. You want your little job. You want your house. And that's all. You're good. You got your kids. You got your car. You're nice. Read Sirach 38:33.
Sirach. 38, verse 33. They shall not be sought for in public council, nor sit high in the congregation. They shall not sit on the judge's seat.
So God is saying he can't, in the kingdom, you're useless to him. You are, men like that are useless to him. Go ahead.
Nor understand the sentence of judgment.
And your understanding is lacking. Go ahead.
They cannot declare justice and judgment. And they shall not be found where parables are spoken.
Let's find out why. Read.
But they will maintain the state of the world.
You tried to save your little life. You want to be a rapper. You want to be an actor. You want to be a sportsman. And you are clueless about God's will for you. Read that again.
But they will maintain the state of the world.
You're going to pay your taxes. You're going to pay your dues in this world. Go ahead.
And all their desire is in the work of their craft.
And all your desire is maintaining America. That's what your whole life consists upon.
You sit down with them, Bishop. All they talking about is their job. What their boss got.
Yeah.
What the managers got.
Exactly.
They know the finances, the ins and outs of how much a company made. There's a nigga at work who knows exactly what the company made. I'm like, I don't give a damn how much the company made.
Right. Exactly.
You know, to the dollar, they had a meeting, and this how much millions of dollars. Who cares?
Right. Give me 1 Corinthians 3:19. I know time is short. I'm going to try and rush through it, but I just want to get through this. 1 Corinthians 3:19. Watch this.
1 Corinthians 3:19. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness
with
God.
So the wisdom of this world is foolishness. All that you got in this world is foolishness. That's what God is saying to us. Go ahead.
For it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain.
Right. So all your thoughts are vain. From there, give me 1 Corinthians 10:31.
First Corinthians 10:31. Wherefore, therefore, ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God.
So Paul said, whatever we do in this world, do it all to the glory of the Most High God. Whatever we do. So even with our little jobs, we work. Why? Not just for our family's sake, but for Israel's sake. To help the body. To help things move along that much stronger, that much faster. That's what we do. Give me Ecclesiastes. Go ahead, y'all. So what are you going to say?
You know, it'd be wise if we just merely saw, and I use the term merely loosely. We should merely use our jobs or refer to them as occupations. Refer to them as occupations. And I'm going to explain why. At least that's how I view mine. I use it as a means for me to do this.
Right.
It's not where my head is. I just use it as a means to make my money so that I can come and build Israel. That's period. It. My thoughts is not with building none of that crap. My thoughts is building this.
Exactly. Ecclesiastes 9 and 10. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 10. Goes with what we just read in Corinthians. Remember, Paul also said, use this world, but don't abuse it. We are supposed to, whatever we can get out of this world, use it to the glory of the Most High. Everything we can use, let's use it.
Ecclesiastes 9, verse 10. Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest.
So, Solomon says, whatever y'all doing as well, do it all to the glory. Do it with all your might to the glory of the Most High. That's what he's saying. Okay, Ephesians 4:28. We're almost done. I want everybody to understand why you work. You might not know why you work. I just work to feed my daughter. More than that. It's more than that.
Ephesians 4, verse 28. Let him that stole steal no more. Why? But rather let him labor, working with his hands.
Why? Go ahead.
The thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
That he may have to give to him that needeth. A Negro or Latino don't understand that. Read it again in its entirety.
Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
It's all about nationhood. That's what he's saying right there. It ain't just about you. We labor in this work. We work for self, family, and race. Self, family, and race, and it all leads to the kingdom of the one true God. But the average black man don't understand. I guess who understands that? The Chinese understand it. Chinese be in your neighborhood selling you pork fried rice, chicken lo mein. You give them $5, they take that money, they bring it back to their neighborhoods. They use it, put that money together, bring another Chinese over. So-called Amalek understand that. They building homes and houses over in your country. You bring all that money, bring it in, send it right over there. But blacks and Latinos, we don't understand verse 428. Read it again.
Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
That he may have to give to him that needeth. One of the examples I saw in the world, many years ago, y'all Sop and I worked at this job doing security. This was over, this is about 15 years ago or so. Might be a little more than that. More than that. I'm in a store. I told some of y'all know the story. I'm in a store. Amalek comes in. He says, may I please speak to the Escava, what's his name? Escava. I forgot the first name. So I said, he's not here. I said, but his son is right there. His son is about 25. Amalek runs into the store. He falls down at the demon's knees, grabbing his knees, crying. I'm looking. I'm doing security. I'm looking. What the hell is going? What is going on here? He is crying at the devil's knees. The dude is 25 years old. He's thinking. I'm thanking him. He's coming back. So I grab. I say, hey, let me ask you a question. I said, what was going on over there? What's wrong with you? You all right? He says, you don't know what about this family? The Escavas? You work for them? You don't know what they do? I said, no, help me out. He says, all the so-called. Right, listen good.
Y'all need to listen to what the bishop is telling y'all. Because it shows you the mind state of the nations as opposed to us.
Exactly.
And the mere fact that he was confident enough to tell us this.
Right. He said all the, he didn't say so-called Jews, I'm saying so-called. He said he organized all of them together. He said every week, they each store takes a portion of their earnings and put it in the bank account. And at, by the end of the year, they use that money to buy a home, whether it be in Brooklyn or Queens, but it's in one of their so-called Jewish neighbors, and they bring a family over. They buy homes and houses for them. He said this has been going on for years.
All those abandoned buildings that y'all been seeing around, and next thing you know, it's bought up, is because they bought them. Because that's how they collectively work collectively. See, that's a term that we got to get familiar with. You're thinking you're individuals. You're not individuals. You're either going to be collective with the Most High, or you'll be collective with Satan.
Exactly. Exactly. Read that verse again. Now we should have a better understanding.
Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth.
That you may have to give to him that needeth. So, the missiles might come tomorrow. We'd be all praising to the Most High. But if the missiles don't come tomorrow, what we going to sit around and twiddle our thumbs? We about building things, brother. So now we got this new building. We going in there tomorrow and start work. It's working time. If you got skills, it's going to be work time. I'm letting y'all know. And guess what? We don't think small. From one, we can get two. From two, we can get three. From three, we can get the whole damn neighborhood. That's how we think.
I think some people believe that now, because when we first said it, they said we were scamming.
Yeah. We ain't no scammers up here, brother. I want you to understand this. This work, in this work, we must overcome our personal fears, our lack of vision, and our low self-esteem. We have to overcome.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel with Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC. To stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.